This is a video about the bones of the forearm, more specifically about the radius and the ulna. The ulna helps flexing and extending your lower arm at the elbow joint, while the radius is the one that rotates, turning your palm down in pronation and back up in supination. So what we are going to do in this video is to go through the parts of each of these bones. We will go through their surface landmarks and then talk a little bit about the joints that hold these two bones together. What's up everyone? My name is Taim. I'm a medical doctor and I make animated medical lectures to make different topics in medicine visually easier to understand. If you'd like a PDF version or a quiz of this presentation, you can find it on my website, along with organized video lectures to help with your studies. Alright, let's get started. We will talk about the radius and then the ulna. Now, the radius is interesting. This is the bone that's on the side of your thumb. Let's isolate it and then zoom in a little bit. The radius is divided into three parts: the proximal end, the body, and the distal end. Let's start with the proximal part. At the very top, we've got the head of the radius. It is shaped like a shallow cylinder and is designed to articulate in two different ways. First, on the very top of the head, we've got a shallow depression that is called the articular facet. This is the surface that makes contact with the capitulum of the humerus to form the humeral-radial joints. Then, wrapping around the edges of the head, we've got the articular circumference. This part does not interact with the humerus, but instead spins against the radial notch of the humerus to form the proximal radio-ulnar joint. Let me show you that visually. First, here's the capitulum of the humerus, and then we've got the radial notch of the ulna. Now, if we remove those labels and take a step back, we can highlight the humeral-radial joint, then the proximal radio-ulnar joint, and also the humeral-ulnar joint beside it, just to show all three in context. These are the three joints that together form the elbow joint, which we went through in details in the last video. So that was the head of the radius. Just below it, we have a narrow region known as the neck of the radius. It's like a little transition zone between the wide head above and the rest of the shaft below. Now, before we continue, let's go ahead and orientate ourselves a little bit to really understand the surfaces of this bone. Here is the radius again, now placed in anatomical position. And here it is in context, showing the anterior view. So you're looking at the front of the forearm. And here's the posterior view, showing the back of the forearm. Let's now isolate the anterior side and the posterior side. With that in context, let's continue by looking at the structures along the body of the radius. So the first thing to note on the shaft is the radial tuberosity. This is a rough projection just below the neck of the radius on the medial side of the anterior surface. It's a really important bony landmark because this is where the biceps brachii tendon inserts. So when the biceps contracts, it pulls on this point and flexes the forearm at the elbow. Now if we look further down along the shaft, we can identify three borders or margins. These help define the surfaces of the radius. First, we have the anterior border, which runs down the front. Then there's the interosseous border, which is on the medial side, facing the ulna. This is where the interosseous membrane attaches, basically a fibrous sheet that connects the radius and the ulna together, helping transmit forces and stabilizing the forearm. And on the back, we've got the posterior border, which is a less distinct but still visible along the posterior aspect of the shaft. Now, between these borders, we can see three surfaces. There's the anterior surface, which lies between the anterior and the interosseous borders. Then the posterior surface, found between the posterior and the interosseous borders. And finally, the lateral surface, which lies between the anterior and the posterior borders on the outer side of the bone. That's it for the body of the radius. Let's now zoom into the distal end of the bone. The first structure we notice here is the styloid process of the radius. This one is really easy to feel on the lateral side of the wrist. This styloid process acts as an important attachment point. We've got the radial collateral ligament of the wrist joint anchoring here, helping stabilize the lateral side of the wrist. And just next to it, there's the palmar radiocarpal ligament, which supports the palm side of the wrist capsule. Now, just above the styloid process, there's a little ridge called the suprastyloid crest. This is where the brachioradialis muscles inserts. This muscle travels down the arm, along the lateral side of the forearm, and it grabs onto this area, helping flex the elbow. On the posterior view, we can see a series of grooves for the extensor tendons. These grooves guide the tendons of muscles, like the extensor pollicis longus and extensor carpi radialis, as they pass into the hand. Right next to those grooves, you can see the dorsal radial tubercle, also known as Lister's tubercle. This is a small but sharp bony ridge that acts like a pulley for the tendon of the extensor pollicis longus. On the medial side, we've got the ulnar notch of the radius. This area accommodates the head of the ulna, forming the distal radio-ulnar joint, which allows the radius to pivot around the ulna during pronation and supination. On the inferior surface of the distal radius, we've got the articular surface of the carpal bones. It's divided into two main articular areas, one for the scaphoid and one for the lunate. Together, these make up the radio-carpal articulations, which is the main joint of the wrist. And that is it for the radius. Let's now turn our attention to the ulna. The ulna, just like the radius, is divided into three parts: a proximal end, the body, and the distal end. Let's start by zooming into the proximal part. Here we can see the olecranon, that big curved projection at the top that forms the bony tip of your elbow. Another thing we can see here is the trochlear notch, which is a large C-shaped surface on the anterior aspect designed to grip the trochlea of the humerus. Just below that, there's the coronoid process that fits into the coronoid fossae of the humerus during elbow flexion. And on the medial side of the coronoid, there's a subtle elevation called the subline tubercle, which serves as an attachment for parts of the ulnar collateral ligament and the flexor digitorum superficialis muscles. Now, let's look at the elbow joint again to see how all these structures fit together. So here's the trochlea of the humerus, and here's the radial notch on the lateral side of the ulna. Then we bring in the articular circumference of the radial head. When we place these elements together, we can clearly see the humero-ulnar joint, where the ulna meets the humerus, and the proximal radio-ulnar joint, where the radius spins against the ulna. Alright, awesome. Let's now take a moment and orientate again. The ulnar bone we just highlighted some structures on, we were actually seeing it from the medial side. And here it is now from the lateral view. Notice how the olecranon fits right into the olecranon fossae of the humerus when your arm is extended. Let's now isolate the ulna from both the medial and the lateral views so we can see it more clearly. And before we move on from the proximal end, there's one more structure we need to look at, and that is the tuberosity of the ulna. You will find this just below the coronoid process, and it serves as the insertion point for the brachialis muscle, which is one of the main flexors of the elbow joint. Okay, let's now talk about the body of the ulna. Just like we did with the radius, we are going to go through its borders and surfaces. We got the anterior border running down the front of the bone. Then we've got the interosseous border, which is on the lateral side facing the radius, and this is where the interosseous membrane attaches. Up near the top of that border is a small ridge. This is called the supinator crest, which is the origin point for the supinator muscle. On the back of the ulna, there's the posterior border, and this one you can actually feel under the skin. It runs down the subcutaneous edge of your forearm. Now, in between those borders, we've got the medial surface, the anterior surface, and the posterior surface, each providing attachment point for different muscles. Alright, let's go ahead and move on to the distal end of the ulna. This part is a little interesting. Even though it's at the wrist level, it doesn't actually participate in the radiocarpal joint. The distal end of the ulna has a rounded area called the head of the ulna. And coming off that is the ulnar styloid process, which is a little bump you can feel on the back and medial side of your wrist. Wrapping around the head is the articular circumference, which contacts the ulnar notch of the radius to form the distal radio-ulnar joint. And on the lateral side of the ulnar head, we can see the articular facet. That is where part of the triangular fibrocartilage complex sits. So that's it for the ulna. Now, just for orientation, we can see the ulnar styloid process here on the medial side, and over here we've got the radial styloid process on the lateral side. And one of the coolest things about the radius and ulna is, thanks to muscles like the pronator quadratus and the pronator teres, they give us the ability to rotate a palm down in pronation or up in supination. And you can see how the radius rotates over the ulna to pronate the hand and then back up again to supinate it. So how are the radius and ulna held together? Well, first, proximally, they are held together by the elbow joint, as we covered earlier. Then distally, we've got the distal radio-ulnar joint. Along the shaft is the interosseous membrane, that strong fiber sheath connecting the bones. And near the top, there's also a small additional structure called the oblique cord, a small ligament that reinforces the connection a bit further. Let's go ahead and zoom into the distal radio ulnar joint now. This is a synovial pivot joint, made up of the ulnar notch of the radius, articulating with the articular circumference of the ulna. It is surrounded by a fibrous capsule and lined by a synovial membrane to allow for smooth rotation. Supporting it from the front is the palmar radio ulnar ligament, and on the back, we've got the dorsal radio ulnar ligament, both of which help stabilize the joint. Now, on the shaft, we've got the interosseous membrane running between the radius and the ulna. This isn't just a passive sheath, it helps distribute force from the radius to the ulna, especially during weight bearing, and it also serves as passage for small vessels and nerves, like the anterior interosseous artery. Now, finally, let's take a closer look at the oblique cord. It's a small fibrous band that stretches from the ulna to the radius, just below the radial tuberosity. And it's not always mentioned in textbooks, but it plays a role in limiting separation between the bones and adding a bit of stability. Alright, that's it for this one. We've covered the radius, the ulna, and the joints and connective tissues that hold them together. I really hope this video helped you visualize and understand this topic better. In the next video, we are going to continue down the upper limb and look at the bones of the wrist and hand, all of the carpal bones, the metacarpals, and the phalanges. Click the next video and I will see you there. If you want handmade PDF version of this lecture, take a quiz to test your knowledge, or access an organized list of all my videos, you can find everything on my website. Thanks for watching, see you next one.